If that is pretty good being free. So what I would do is I would experiment. That's all. You know, when you're practicing, if you just say, okay, I'm just going to play through this piece three times, maybe slowly once, and then up to tempo, medium, and then up to tempo, that may help you get comfortable with the piece, but it may not solve all any issues you have. So I would just experiment. So how free do we want it? So, as I said, it was excellent playing that I heard. When I just wonder the character, besides the freedom issue, how would you describe this piece if you had to describe it, the character of it? I could have used more of the light stuff. I felt it was maybe, for my taste, quite serious, and to me there's some humor in this. I think Rager's sense of humor may not be my sense of humor or your sense of humor, but it's his sense of humor, and we've got to highlight that there's a piece you can listen to for flute, violin, and viola. It's a serenade by Rager. You should listen to it. It's very silly piece, just to see how silly Rager can be. These pieces are like etudes somehow, and it's trying to make them sound like great pieces. Nothing against you, Max. They're great pieces, but do you know what I mean? We want to make this as great as possible. Every piece we want to make is. We want to help it as much as we can. As a matter of fact, I judged the Munich competition years ago, and everybody had to play Rager, and I was thinking, oh my gosh, this is going to be tough just to hear that. But it was very interesting because the people who really made it turn it into music, you know, getting away from that etude thing, those were the people like, oh, they've actually made this rather sort of like this piece into something more, it seemed like more than it was. And it's not that easy to do, but what I would be thinking about is, you know, I hear the different characters when you play, but I would like to hear more of them. So, isn't this sort of fun, this beginning? Is it fun? You know, when you play, I wanted to hear more fun. So how do we make more fun? It's not like like when I play something sad, I don't have to be sad. When I play something fun, I don't have to be happy, but I have to pretend. You know, we're like actors. So how am I gonna act to make this seem like I'm having a lot of fun here? I'm gonna pretend. So what's it? Now I'm going to play it now a little less fun. Let's see what the difference. notes, and I was more free, as you were saying. So look how I'm releasing. See how I release things? And I'm also thinking about the line. So why is that more fun? Because the harmony here, and then, change the harmony, so it's sort of fun. So what we do is we point it out. So I would just think about this. So just play the opening. do your Boeing, but it should have that kind of release. It feels a little bit like you're saying, oh, listen to this. It's sort of like this. Wait to shift. little tone, and those things, like, oh, that makes the piece more interesting, with all due respect, than what's there. And I think that Max, if I may call him that, would be happy with that, that you fooled around with this piece. So I think we're going to have to stop it. I want you to listen to that Serenade by Max Reger, and you'll see a really silly piece. And it will, maybe will be helpful for this. But thank you for your excellent planning.
415 or something, so it was,
right.
It was a lot different.
But it sort of sounds like a viola da gamba or something. It's sort of a very Baroque sounding instrument. So I was thinking, wow, you know, Schubert wrote it for this instrument that sounds like this. So why does everyone play it like it's a romantic piece? Now you may say, well, it's written in later in Schubert's short life, more in his romantic period, perhaps. Or maybe it's because people like Rostropovich made a beautiful recording that's very romantic, and the people say, oh, listen to Rostropovich, it's so gorgeous. Look how beautiful he makes this piece. But he's doing a lot of, you know, sliding and lots of freedom with the rhythms. So I listened to that, I said, maybe this should be a classical piece. So first thing I did is like, I'm gonna try to get rid of every slide that I can, number one. Number two, I'm gonna go through this piece and figure out where are these places where everyone slows down, where it's not marked. Say, do I need to slow down there, or is it because these people do it? Sometimes you need a little time. Sometimes you just can't go straight ahead. You just need something to make it make sense. But I got rid of a lot of the traditional stuff that I decided, you know, tradition, how does tradition happen? Someone takes a little time, you take a little time, and then 2 weeks later, you've done a little bit more, and it grows and grows, and this turns into a tradition of yours, and other people have said, oh, that sounded so nice the way you played that. I'm gonna take some time there too. And they take more time. So that's how these, perhaps, this is how traditions like that start. You just say, well, is that a good tradition? What would Mr. Schubert think? We don't know. He might say, oh, I love it in a romantic style. So I can't say for sure, but I play everything as much as I can in the lower register to match the arpeggio register. That's because when you're switching the octaves around, the problem is we can't go low enough on a standard viola. We can't play deep enough. So you have to make compromises. The question is, what compromises are you going to make? There's no perfect answer. You have to decide. For me, I decided, wait a second, it's meant to be in this low register. It matches with the piano. When you raise it an octave, the piano's not raising an octave. So that right there is an issue. And also, just like when it suddenly jumps up, maybe because I'm used to it in a certain way, oh, what's that about? So those were things I like to keep in mind as I'm playing them. Change is, you may say, well, maybe it's nice for me. Throw it out the door. That's all I say. But in any case, I'm trying to make it elegant. Forget the slides, but you know, you see the. I'm also flowing a little bit more than yours is a little bit. And also, you sometimes do slide. Going back to slides, you know, you go. You finish something and then you do, you know what I'm talking about? You do slides like that, and I'm sure that you're doing them on purpose, and I assume you like them. I would think about all those slides. It's that, and experiment with it. Taste is taste. I'm not saying I have perfect taste, or anybody does, but you have to. You're doing slides that are just like, after, it's not like a slide, it's sort of like a release of a note where you go down. Let's just hear the beginning and just try it once. Try it once, forget about all the slides. Try to move it a little bit more, a little lighter. See if you like that kind of approach. You're leaving the boat. see that because it looks funny. So just practice, like, how little would I need to lift? And making sure that the sound doesn't stop. Your posture is a little bit like this, and it'd be nice. I'm not saying you should be anything like this, but in the Reader's Digest version, I want this thing. See how I'm moving this around? This is a piece of wood. This is not natural what I'm doing. It sort of looks natural, right? It's not. I'm pretending to make this look natural, and then I'm pretending that this is all natural. This is not. I want it to seem that way. Postures like this. Everything I do, like you have this machine here that is also making you stuck in a certain fashion. If I have a machine, I think it's called a shoulder rest, I would say that. Fritz Kreisler, perhaps the greatest violinist of all time, right? Now, you can see that Mr. Kreisler is playing from, you can see this afterward, from, you see he's playing. What's he doing with that violin?
It's pointed upwards.
It's not only pointed upwards. How's he holding it? He's obviously holding it only with his left hand because it looks something like this. It's just remarkable. It's like, how are you playing? That's what he's doing. And this guy played incredible. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, I love that picture. It's like, how are you doing that? Because back then, people held it much more with their left hand. But, for another day. Thank you very much for your excellent
sometimes I feel that my bones are a little bit shaky. Sometimes, especially when I'm a little bit nervous. I think that's, I think that's the main thing I was thinking of.
Okay. Well, you move around a lot, and if you move around a lot, sometimes that can affect the shakiness of the bone too, you know what I mean?
Mm.
To me, you're moving around a little distracting for me, for my taste. And, you know, if it sounds good, maybe it doesn't matter, right? But, you know, people are coming to the concert to hear you play beautifully and also to look at you, right? They're looking at you, otherwise they could put on a recording. So, you're doing a lot of this, and you're also like before some of the entrances, you like are leading. She doesn't need necessarily some of this leading. I don't know how you feel about it, but sometimes you're like you're doing some stuff before some entrances that are maybe not needed. So you have this shoulder rest thing, and as we're saying, you missed the picture. Look how Mr. Fritz Preissler is holding that violin. He's not holding the violin. He's holding with the left hand. I had the great privilege of taking master classes with William Primrose. Mr. Primrose, of course, he did not like shoulder rests. None of the old players did. First of all, it didn't exist until a certain point. But Primrose could certainly have used one if he felt it was needed. And he said, you know, I just hold the viola with my left hand. Oops. And he said, look, I can play anywhere. I don't need this. That's what he said to us. I don't want to clamp down on this thing. That's not going to be a good thing because I'm tight. I want to be loose. You want to be loose. You're moving around a lot because you want to be loose. So we asked Mr. Primrose, how do you shift? Which would be the most important question. If you're holding the viola in the left hand, how are you going to... How am I going to move that? I can do that. That's not easy. So Mr. Primrose said, oh, I just slipped on my shoulder. Look what I'm going to do. Generous, whatever, but it would be worth exploring. If you've always move it around this way, but you're compensating by this way. Another thing I notice is this, like your pinky and stuff is like up like this. You know what I mean?
Right.
So habits are hard to break. I can't, if you ask me to change anything at this point, forget about it. I'm not changing anything. I can't. But, and I know it's hard. How do you deal with that? I'll tell you one thing. For me, home base of the viola is right here in these two strings, the middle strings. It's not here. Do you know what I mean? This is not where I'm starting from. Because if I'm starting from here, everything's sort of like, if I want to go to the C string, it's a big journey. If I'm here, my journey's very short. This is my journey to the C string. Here's my journey to the A string. See how everything is concise? To me, I want to make everything as concise as possible, and I want to work as little as I can. And so my bow arm also is home base there. And I'm using very little movement. Your first teacher, and my first teacher, and everybody's first teacher, had levels, right? Much movement. More movement doesn't make it more relaxed. It, to me, that's enough. know what I mean? If you're saying the more I move, the more relaxed I am, the thing is, I'm going to exaggerate. This is not you, but if I did that, what happens? Everything has to react to that. So if I move down like this, that means this is moving here. If I go, this says it's a lot of accommodating the movement. And as I said, you should move. I think I really do think you should move, but just to think. When you hear it from other teachers or colleagues, and enough people say something similar, it's advice, and it's for you. That's why when you play for different people, it can be very helpful, especially like your teacher says something to you all the time, whatever that is. Say, oh, he always or she always says the same thing. And then another teacher says the same thing, and they think, oh, maybe I should listen to my teacher. You know what I mean? That sometimes that reinforces something you've heard before. Now, let's try something fun. Take off that machine. Oh, my teacher, when I was 10, made me throw it away. I haven't used it since. That's all I'm going to say. Try that. Have you ever tried that? You think it's going to slip?
I'll see how it goes.
Okay. Just very tough, very tough. Feel good. another, you know, since because I'm playing this where I can add. sitting there, what would you, what do you think you would say to yourself?
Maybe more of a connection, like, I feel like I'm not conveying the music to the audience.
And when you practice, do you feel that it's coming across and it was just right now, or is it always that way?
I always feel that way, like I'm very unsure if it is, if it's not.
If it's, what, you mean the colors you're getting, are they going out there?
Yeah.
Right. I heard colors, but I wanted to hear more colors. The thing is that when we're playing, everything we do is amplified by a billion times. I play and I think, oh my gosh, that was so out of tune, that was so flat. And I listen to recording, well, maybe it was on the low side, but maybe I overreacted. You know, everything seems like a lot, and so, oh, I did that color. They're gonna hear that color and say, okay, not. So sometimes we've gotta be more blatant about it. Oh, I'm gonna make more special color. Okay. I'd like a little more tight on that. Everybody has a machine, too. So, there. You get to number two, it, yes, it's strong, but I think it's also a new color opportunity. This piece has so many opportunities. It's all, when you're working with orchestras, it's all about being heard. And you're, this is a big piece, it's a big piano part. So when the piano's playing big, you want to make sure you're getting out there. If you go like this, now I think it's nice, you're communicating, you're turning in. You can't do that. You just, because, you know, if I think I'm getting more sound out of the instrument, but I would be very aware if you move your viola, what's going to happen with that sound in the hall? And where am I going to put it? I'm reacting to the sound that's happening. If I play in a chamber group and everyone's playing big, well, I guess I should play big. This is life. And so how do we get sound? Sound, you know, the, you can get a little more sound out of this. grid is not okay. So, and also, how much bow speed do we need? Through my legs to here, and these are my tree trunks, whatever. I'm using that strength. See, the way I stand, if I stand this way, like this, I want to feel strong. I want to, it's like, you want your stance, like if I were to push you, how could you stop me from doing it? What kind of stance? That's how strong you want to feel. Then you want to be flexible here. So, I have the, I feel that strength. I'm using that strength, even though ideas. For me, I like to keep everything relaxed. It's just, I'm a Beyonce, I'm a Californian, and I'm a Libra. These are very relaxed things. Is that, I can even move. I'm just amazed sometimes. These are too many things going against any kind of energy. So I want to be strong and relaxed. So my posture in a perfect world, you can see me play and say, oh, he doesn't do that. In a perfect world, my posture would be like everything. Unfortunately, it isn't. But that's what I'm aiming for in a perfect world. We don't live in it. You see my posture? I'm trying to, yes, I want flexibility, but I don't want to do anything in excess that I don't need to. Because there's enough to worry about that anything that contorts anything. I'm not saying you're all over the place. All I'm just saying is that the machine, whatever, if you're a little stuck here, could be more relaxed, as we were just saying previously. Trying the idea of playing with more of the left hand and say, I can move this thing. If I'm using the shoulder rest, it doesn't necessarily have to be resting there, like it's suspended from the ceiling. You know what I mean? I want it to feel like this is a natural thing. If it's like this, it's not natural, you see? I'm stuck. It's a big, just between this and that. You know what I mean? If I go, these are tense. Let's relax. Always thinking about relax. Okay, let's see how you're standing there. You're standing like this. That relax? Let's see how you stand. Feels good. Right now I have tension on just one finger. Don't do this. Don't interrupt your viola. But I'm holding that viola with one finger in the scroll. It's pretty relaxed. There's a little tension there. But everything I do, I can think about how I walk down the street. If I walk like this or whatever, is that tense? And you may say, he's crazy, but I want to be strong but relaxed. As far as playing goes, excellent playing. As I said, you know, you have wonderful instincts to exaggerate all these things and think about your sound production. You know, make sure you don't turn it too much. You want to, you know, we're never loud enough. Even when people tell us to be quiet, it's never loud enough. You know, in chamber music, we're facing the wrong way. Our colleagues think that we're playing loud because they hear it. They don't hear it out there. It's a never-ending source of but you know, so that's what we have to deal with as a viola. As a viola. But the nice thing is that we play the most beautiful instrument of all, right? Yes. We do. Say yes, we do play. Thank you. Thanks. But no one will certify that. So this was in the Busch Quartet. Anybody who knows all the great old quartets, the Busch Quartet was one of the most famous, or the most famous quartet. And then came the Budapest and other quartets after that. And you can hear this viola in the Busch Quartet recordings with Carl Doctor. As I said earlier, Paul Doctor was my godfather. Carl Doctor was his father. And this was his viola that Carl Doctor played. And Paul Doctor played this instrument that's called a grand chino. So I'm very fortunate to have both of those violas. And I don't, what, who played it before Carl Doctor? Not the slightest idea. But since Carl Doctor played, it was under Paul Doctor's piano. that when you hear people play, quite often, sometimes, should I say sometimes, you hear someone play, right? To me, that sounds like, that's what it sounds like to me. And you may say, what is he talking about? It sounds perfectly fine to me. But I'll do that in slow motion. That's what I'm exaggerating 1,000%. But that's the idea. When something isn't articulated, that's what's happening. Now, on this piano, there are, when you press down a note, there's a hammer. It hits the string. That's what I want to do when I play. I want to bring my finger down like the hammer of the piano. Not slapping it down, unless it's a contemporary piece that calls for that. But I want it to come down firmly and quickly. And I don't want to move my finger unless I'm vibrating or I want a particular color for some reason. So my finger comes down firmly. Do you hear that? And when I release my finger, it's like that hammer of the piano. So I'm going to show you the difference. Or maybe I'm exaggerating. But if you start thinking about it and you listen to people and you say, wait a second, is that as clear as it can be? Last question. tastes. For me, partly it's the players, but I listen to old recordings. Those are the people that I love, you know, Chrysler, Elman, Primrose, Turtis, all of the old ones. I love that. And I also love that the salon music and the that style of playing really speaks to me. But not that I don't like a nice someone doing something fancy Baroque thing. That, oh, that's actually pretty good. You know. But like on the radio, there's a station I'm going to give a plug for. KCEA. If you go online, listen to the station. It's the music Swing Time and big band music from the 1930s and 40s. It's fun stuff. I like that stuff. I love gypsy music. We can't say gypsy anymore. The Roma music. Love that. I like the salon music. But I honestly, I love that stuff personally, and the composers that you've never heard of. There are lots of composers that here in Portland, we played a number of years ago the music of Alfredo D'Ambrosio, one of the great composers from Naples, probably the most wonderful composer from Naples. He wrote two pieces of chamber music. We play them here, Chamber Music Northwest. It's like Chrysler meets Italy. But D'Ambrosio, for all violinists, should know, of course, his short pieces. He wrote tons of beautiful short pieces. Anybody know that? No? Whatever. It's just such charming things. Those pieces, like some of them were recorded by Fitz and Elman and violinists like that. Just beautiful, gorgeous thing. And one last thing, when you play music like that, there are words I live by. You must respect the schlock. Do you know what I mean? If you go. Thank you for your wonderful playing. Great.